Good morning and welcome to St. John's. Welcome to the 11 o'clock service today. It is good to see each one of you here. Let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship now.
Thank you.
as we pray together the opening prayer found in your bulletin. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, you called us like a good parent to you, to guide and protect us, to nourish and lead us. Jesus, you call us like a caring elder brother to serve us and help us, to cheer us and invite us. Healing Spirit, you call us and move us ever closer into fellowship with you and each other. Open our hearts that we may learn to overcome anything that divides us in the truth that we are all one family in your love. Open our hearts and minds to learn again to live your love as we celebrate and worship today. Amen. Welcome again to St. John's this morning. The friendship pads are located near the center aisles, and we invite you to put your name down. And if you are new to St. John's, please give us a way to contact you this week. And we welcome you here. I remind you that this Thursday here in the sanctuary, our Under the Steeple series will be hosting the King's Brass. They will be here at 7:30. This would be a great time to invite friends or neighbors to come and enjoy this special performance and be here at St. John's. Vacation Bible School is almost here. It's not too late to sign up those children and grandchildren, and I imagine there might be a spot or two for a volunteer if you're interested. So we are glad that you are here today, and take time to look at the newsletter for more information. Today we recognize two different groups that have done a lot of work this year. We celebrate first the commissioning of three new Stephen ministers who have completed 50 hours of training. They met weekly from January through June. This training was coordinated by St. John's, but it was done along with St. Mary's and St. Paul's and First Presbyterian. And so I invite now our three new Stephen ministers, Jim Hartsook, Ginger Hudock, and Joan Gallagher, to come forward. And our Stephen leaders are joining them as well, Rick Endler and Bob Koski and Steve Lathrop. And Alice Allington is out of town today.
And I'd like all the other Stephen ministers, those who've already completed their training, if they would stand. There are a lot around. Let's give them a hand. Stephen ministry is a wonderful way that this church serves. It's more than a nurture program. We have our Shepherd of Love program that I commend to you. We have members of our congregation who go out and visit people on a regular basis. We have Reverend Nancy who offers nurture. We have myself as well and others of this congregation through all sorts of means that reach out to the community. But Stephen Ministers is an organization that is very detailed, very much an organization, a ministry that promotes training. It promotes all of the ways that people can lend more than just a listening ear, but provide care in significant ways that we celebrate, and we give you thanks for what you've been dedicated to and what these leaders have been dedicated to and all the other persons who serve on behalf of this denomination and this church. So today we celebrate that you have completed this training. We thank you for all that you've done. Jim and Ginger and Joan have worked hard, and we are grateful for you doing that. They've worked hard today because they've been at all three services. You get a taste for, it's an interesting life to do all three, and there you go. So I may need to talk to you sometime soon. So Joan and Ginger and Jim, you have promised faithfully to serve the Lord Jesus as Stephen ministers. I commend you to the care and guidance of the Holy Spirit as you in turn care for others. We know that you'll work diligently for the Lord. And we pray that you will use your skills that you've learned, releasing God's Spirit as you minister to others. And we're going to pray for you. But before we do that and commission you, there are certificates that we want to give to you. Joan Gallagher, Ginger Hudock, and Jim Hartsook. And now let us pray. Oh God, we ask you to take Jim and Ginger and Joan into your care and use them as ministers of this church. You have blessed them with particular gifts, and you have provided them with an opportunity to learn more about helping people, and they have diligently done so, and we're grateful for their leaders, and we're grateful for the great company of all those others, not only of Stephen Ministry in this congregation, but every other aspect of ministry that reaches out and welcomes and offers hospitality and grace to those in need. Oh Lord, bless them so that they may be quick to serve, patient in listening, and willing to share of themselves with others. We give thanks for Jim and Ginger and Joan and for those that they will serve in this ministry. Bless and use these three and all who serve as Stephen ministers here at St. John's as they care for others. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you. God bless you. And now it's a joy to celebrate those who have finished Disciple 2, Disciple Bible Study. If you've never heard of Disciple Bible Study, it's an intensive, basically almost a year-long experience for 32 weeks, several hours, 2 or 3 hours at a meeting led by Rob Braithwaite. They have been learning about Genesis and Exodus and Luke and Acts and Disciple number 2. Disciple 1 is all through the Bible. I would commend all of the Disciple Bible Studies to you. We're very grateful for the persons who have finished Disciple Bible Study. And I would like to ask our new persons who've been through Disciple to stand. I'm looking. Maybe the balcony. Oh, I see one. Well, you'll see their names. That's Keith Polk up there. And his wife Julie is another one. And Rob Braithwaite I see up there as well now. And Rob, thank you for teaching. But you'll see the names of those, Bobby Coker, Phyllis Coker, Dolores Fish, Peggy Neal, Keith Polk, Julie Polk, Tim Perkins, and Johnny and Judy Turner. A number of these we recognize at our two earlier services today. But we want to say thank you for the intensive work that you've done and the ways that you've learned the Scriptures. And if we would all learn the Scriptures as well, this would be a better world in which we live, and we would be more informed about what God's will is. So I want to say a special word of gratitude, and let us show our gratitude to these who have given of themselves. And while I'm here, I want to make mention of a couple of other things before we have our ministry minute, which will be exciting. I want you to pay close attention. While I'm here, I want to say a word on behalf of Ryan and Michelle Orr, who usually sit on my right near the back, whose son Benton had a heart valve replacement at MUSC this past week. He's already out of the hospital. Now, they're still in Charleston, but Michelle wanted me specifically to tell you all thank you for your prayers, because he's doing so well. And six doors down from him is Trish and Steve Suture's grandson, Jonesy, Robert Jones Suture, who is a 10-month-old who got a heart transplant 2 weeks ago, and he's doing exceptionally well. So thank you for your prayers. I know that there are other prayer concerns that Reverend Nancy will lift up as she does the pastoral prayer in a few moments, but we're grateful to God for his grace, his power, his healing power specifically in the lives of these we've mentioned. The other thing that I want to lift up is the Congo offering that I popped on you last week. The North Katanga Annual Conference in the Congo, a place where I've been, it's a place where there are great needs. Their annual conference starts July 1st. We've got until tomorrow morning to, I hope, to send at least $10,000. All you need to do is get an envelope in front of you, put whatever amount you want to put in there and write Congo on it, Congo. And it will be sent tomorrow morning to the General Board of Global Ministries securely, and then will be sent to the Congo without anybody able to take anything out of it. It will go directly to the need, because we've got at least 1,000 pastors who are leaving their families behind without protection and care as they travel through cholera-infested waters, as they hike and bike their way across that whole area with Ebola and cholera both being rampant. So I hope that we will do our part to help out. And I want to say thank you to those of you who have already given. And I'm grateful, and I know that these people will be grateful. They are wonderful folks. God bless them, and God bless you in giving. And now, Jim and Charlotte.
We're going to do something just slightly different, and it's highly professionally done. I think you'll be impressed, okay? Good morning. My name's Jim Holly.
Good morning.
I don't think we've met, have we?
I don't believe we have. Okay. Good morning. I'm Charlotte Smith, and I recently moved to town.
Well, good. It's great to meet you. I look forward to get to know you, and I hope you'll have a great Sunday and a great week ahead.
Thank you. That really means a lot to me. I recently, as I said, moved here, and I live alone, and I haven't had an opportunity to meet many people yet, so sometimes I get a little lonely.
Well, I think we all do at times, but I have a great Sunday school class with a lot of wonderful people, and I'd like for you to meet them. Excuse me, if you have a few minutes, I'll introduce you to them.
Sure.
All right. Good morning. You can hold the applause, okay? Charlotte and I are here on behalf of the Hospitality and Evangelism Committee to talk with you about hospitality and evangelism. And as I've mentioned earlier today twice, I doubt we'll be nominated for any Academy Awards, but at least what we did was from the heart and hopefully is a good example. May I read to you Hebrews 13, 1 through 2. Let mutual love continue. Do not neglect to show hospitality to strangers, for by doing that, some have entertained angels without knowing it. These verses remind us how we interact with those we encounter every day, especially here at church, at worship, or at activities, is important. It reminds us that by just briefly speaking with someone warmly and hospitably that's new to us or new to St. John's, we may possibly impact their lives in just a few minutes. We do not know if they're lonely, they're hurting, what problems they're dealing with, or they may even be an angel of some kind. A smile and a warm greeting from one of us may change a lonely person's day. Making room for a family in your pew by your moving farther in may help them understand that they are important to you and to us. Escorting someone to a place or room they are looking for lets us know that they're important to us and that we want to slow down and take time to help them. Inviting someone to a class, a Sunday school class, or any other class may lead to new relationships, or even possibly open the door to a new life of faith. We never know what God has in front of us if we take the opportunity to slow down and speak. Simple actions like these we all can do. That will make our guests and visitors, and even the members of this congregation, feel welcome and loved. And perhaps in doing that for a few moments, someone will even glimpse the love of our Lord for them. So keep your eyes open all the time, especially here, for opportunities to share and to greet and to love other peoples. This can make a real difference in a person's life. And guess what? In doing these things, you may have done something that you thought you would never do. You've become an evangelist for our Lord by simply loving somebody and speaking to them. So let's do that. Let's engage in that type of path in our lives. God puts people in our paths for a reason. So let's take the opportunity to greet them and love them. May this congregation become one that this is our entire way of life each and every Sunday and each and every day. May we be a congregation where there is no stranger. And I have one other announcement, if I may make while I'm here. And at least until this message I just said and shared with you, I would say amen. At the end of the service, during the recessional, the choir will come into the congregation and greet you. So I hope you look forward to that as they show their hospitality and greeting to you. Thank you.
Stand as we affirm our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you.
be seated. Let us pray. Dear God, thank you for sending Jesus, who calls us to be brothers and sisters. Bless all who we call family, whether they are relatives or friends. We are grateful for these new Stephen ministers who joined the Stephen ministry team and will quietly step up to listen and walk with those who face uncertainties in their lives. Assure those who might benefit from a relationship with them and give them courage to seek the help found in this ministry. We're also grateful for this class of disciple students who have spent time in your word and have learned and shared with each other as they have grown in their faith. Remind us that we can turn to you, God, and that you have sent your Holy Spirit to guide us and to comfort us always. We are all children of God, and let us find our way to be family to all. Lord, there are many on our hearts this day from this congregation who have faced surgeries this last week. Lord, continue to bless them, bring healing to their bodies. Lord, bless those who may be having struggles this week. Comfort them, lift them up. And now we pray together as Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. All that we have comes from God. Now we are given a chance to give back a portion of that. Our ushers will come forward to receive our tithes and our offerings. Thank you. remain standing as we sing our hymn of preparation, number 576. And we invite our children to follow the Crucifer to Children's Church, which is located in our chapel.
Please remain standing for the gospel lesson. From Mark's gospel, the third chapter, beginning at verse 20. Then Jesus entered a house, and again a crowd gathered, so that he and his disciples were not even able to eat. And when his family heard about this, they went to take charge of him, for they said, "He is out of his mind." And the teachers of the law who came down from Jerusalem said, "He is possessed by Beelzebul. By the prince of demons he is driving out demons." And so Jesus called them over to him and began to speak to them in parables. How can Satan drive out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. If a house is divided against itself, that house cannot stand. And if Satan opposes himself and is divided, he cannot stand. His end has come. In fact, no one can enter a strong man's house without first tying him up, and then he can plunder the strong man's house. Truly, I tell you, people can be forgiven all their sins and every slander they utter, but whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit will never be forgiven. They are guilty of an eternal sin. He said this because they were saying he has an impure spirit. Then Jesus' mother and brothers came, and standing outside, they sent someone in to call him. A crowd was sitting around him, and they told him, "Your mother and brothers are outside looking for you." "Who are my mother and my brothers?" Jesus asked. And then he looked at those seated in a circle around him and said, "Here are my mother and my brothers and my sisters. Whoever does God's will is my brother and sister and mother." This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. It's not June 21st yet, but it feels like summer has arrived. Summertime is a wonderful time of year. It's when we have our summertime reunions, and I recall the third Sunday in July as one of the dates on my reunion calendar, or the second Saturday in August. Those are dates on my calendar for reunion. But you know what I found is sometimes at reunion time, there's a little bit of competition. Who's the oldest? Who's the youngest? Who brought the most people? Who came from the farthest distance? All those little trivial things, but it starts adding up as people ponder and look around. I've even found myself at not exactly family reunion time, but other times of family gatherings, been in a little bit of competition with my Baptist preacher brother-in-law, who loves to pray for not only the turkey, but the dressing, but everything else and everybody else and all the turkey's friends and family members, and has these prayers that by the time the prayers end, the food is starting to get cold. So I decided one year, and my father-in-law gave me the permission to give it a whirl to see if the Methodist preacher could pray and somehow win out in this little prayer competition. And so I said, let us bow our heads. Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, first in line, gets the most. Amen. Well, that's not exactly a very good prayer, even though it does invoke the Trinity. It's interesting how we can have family squabbles over the most important things and sometimes the least important things. And if Jesus, even in his own family, did not find it without its complications, what should we expect? If Jesus could endure the family squabble where even his mother and his brothers and his sisters, his whole family, besides Joseph, his father, who had already passed away, they all said, he's out of his mind. Who does he think he is? God? And he did. Can you imagine being the brother-in-law to Jesus? Or the sister-in-law or the cousin? This is my Uncle Jesus. That could be a complex family gathering. Now we know, we believe in the virgin birth. We know that we believe totally that Jesus is human and totally that Jesus is divine. But he had half brothers and half sisters. It says so in Mark's Gospel, the 6th chapter, just a few pages to the right. In verse 3 it says his brothers' names were Judas and Simon and James and Joseph. And it says the same thing in Matthew's Gospel, the 13th chapter, the verses 55 through 57. Now, there are those who will translate those words as kinsmen, as relatives, and there are others who will say that, no, these actually mean Jesus' literal half-brothers and half-sisters. If Jesus has difficulty with his family thinking he's out of his mind, what in the world is going to come of us? So what do we do when we deal with family difficulties, whether they take place at a summertime reunion or family squabble that takes place at our own homes? Well, one of the things that I find myself doing is I tend to kitchen sink. You know what it means to kitchen sink, don't you? Like when you're going on vacation for a week, but your husband or your spouse packs everything, including the kitchen sink, even though it's just for 1 week. Kitchen sinking means that we bring up everything like a kitchen sink. We bring up everything that they've ever done wrong, hardly remembering the things done well. We kitchen sink rather than listen. Aesop said, a fable, but a truism, I believe, and I think it occurred with Jesus and his siblings and even with his mom. Aesop said, familiarity breeds contempt. Familiarity breeds contempt, even for Jesus. It's a little bit like the elderly man who just got his first set of hearing aids. He went back to the hearing doctor to get everything checked out, and the hearing doctor said, your hearing is now perfect. You can hear everything. I'm sure, the doctor said, I'm sure your family is delighted. He says, I haven't told them. I've just been sitting around listening, and I've already changed my will 3 times. That's not the type of listening that helps us get over kitchen sinking. Real listening means that we listen to what is being said and the process, perhaps even more importantly, the process in which it is said. In other words, it's not what we say as much as how we say it. For instance, if I said, you're a nut. Now, that's the content. But then if I looked at Rick and said, you're a nut, I've said the same thing, but one was in a pleasant, applauding sort of way, and one was in a condemning, critical sort of way. It's not the content of what we say that's important. It's the process in which we say it. Don't we know that? So what we need to practice is somewhat like Fred Rogers. Fred Rogers, the ordained Presbyterian minister, Mr. Rogers' neighborhood, who would take off his cardigan and then sit down on the bench and take off his shoes and put on his slippers. And then he would sing that song, "It's a beautiful day in the neighborhood, a beautiful day for a neighbor. Would you be mine? Could you be mine?" That kind of invitational listening where he takes off that cardigan as he takes off his shoes. And almost in the Middle Eastern Jesus-like way, he says, "Let me listen to you." Wouldn't this world be a better place if we quit kitchen sinking all the issues that we have from our past and we really listened? We really listened. And then sometimes we not only kitchen sink rather than listen, we lick our wounds. We lick our wounds. We had a family friend who had the biggest dog I've ever seen in my life. I mean, I've seen some big dogs, but this dog, it was a Great Pyrenees. I don't know if you know anything about Great Pyrenees. This dog named Sebastian weighed 185 pounds. He weighed more than most of you, okay? I'm not looking that closely at him. He weighed more than all of you. But Sebastian was huge, and when Sebastian would jump up on you, you were on the floor. When Sebastian was having a good time and felt like he was loved, Sebastian's big tail, boom, boom, it knocked over glasses, it knocked over plates, it knocked food on the floor. It knocked things so hard that finally Sebastian's tail at the very end got infected. And so they had to take Sebastian to the doctor, to the vet. And as they took Sebastian, things didn't go so well. Sebastian lost a little tip of his tail. But that didn't keep Sebastian from licking his wound. You know, sometimes licking our wounds doesn't do any good. It actually makes things worse. And so they fitted Sebastian with an XXXXXL lampshade collar so he could not get to his tail. But, well, he would get in the corner, big self as he was, and he would get to that tail, and they finally had to nip a little bit more off. And guess what? It didn't end there, literally. He kept licking his wound to the point that he was the only Great Pyrenees bobtail dog that I'd ever seen. Huge dog, small tail. There's a sermon in there somewhere. And I think it's this. If we lick our wounds, we find ourselves hurting ourselves more than the persons that we dislike. Corrie Ten Boom went back to Germany after World War II. She had been in prison along with her baby sister, Betsy. She had been mistreated. Her sister, Betsy, had been mistreated and brutalized and assaulted. But Corrie Ten Boom felt like she should go back to Germany and preach the good news of Jesus Christ, that there is forgiveness. Her sister, Betsy, had died at the hands of the Nazi captors in a concentration camp. And so she would preach about God's grace, and she said, "God wants to forgive each of us, and God wants us to put up a sign that says, as He throws our sins as far as to the uttermost parts and depths of the ocean, He wants us to put up a sign that says, no fishing allowed, no licking wounds, get over it." And one night as she was sharing the gospel, and she invited people to come forward, a former Nazi concentration camp guard who had been terrible to her sister came forward and said, "Will you forgive me?" And she says, woodenly almost, she reached out her arm and she took the man's hand. And she said, "I forgive you." And she said she felt electricity go from her shoulder all the way down her arm, all the way to the tips of her fingers. And she felt as if a prisoner had been set free. And then she said, "And the prisoner was me." If we don't forgive, if we lick our wounds, we find ourselves hurting our own lives. We become a little bit like the woman who became a Christian. These were her words. I'm so glad I got religion. I have an uncle I hate so much. I vowed I would never go to his funeral, but why now I would be delighted to go to it any time. I'm a little bit concerned about her level of not licking her wounds. There needs to be true forgiveness. We need to stop carrying grudges and carry our brothers and carry our sisters. We need to stop carrying grudges. There was a man and his wife who ended up before a judge, and the woman said to the judge, I want a divorce. And so the judge looked at the woman and said, well, do you have any ground? She said, well, we own about 3 acres. The judge looked at her, and then he thought, well, I'll rephrase the question. Do you have a grudge? She said, no, we have a carport. Well, ma'am, let me ask it another way. Why do you really want to get a divorce? And she said, well, it's simple. He can't carry on an intelligent conversation. Whose problem was it? When we carry grudges instead of carrying our brothers and sisters, we end up putting up a barbed wire enclosure around our lives. You know, barbed wire can come in handy. It can keep out intruders or cattle rustlers or things like that, intruders or predators. But sometimes it's a horrible thing if we put it up between those that we're supposed to love. I'm reminded of Jesus and his dealing with the family squabble. Somehow, he was able to give up that grudge, or maybe, I pray, by God's grace, he never had one. And I'm sure, as a matter of fact, since Jesus never sinned, that he never had a grudge. But it's interesting to me to think of forgiveness, that here was James listed in this list of his brothers, James, who ended up becoming the leader of the church in Jerusalem. Somehow, James was able to have a bridge back to understanding who Jesus really was and finding grace. When we carry grudges instead of carrying our brothers and sisters, we hurt ourselves. We hurt everybody else. A man said to his wife, as they were discussing living wills, the man said to her, just so you know, I never want to live in a vegetative state dependent on some machine and fluids from a bottle. If that happens, just pull the plug. And so she got up and unplugged the television and threw out all his beer bottles. Just saying. Teacher and students at a zoo, they were taking turns naming the animals without looking at the nameplates in front of each enclosure at the zoo. And the teacher got to this little boy and said, it's your turn. And he looked at the animal. It was a deer, by the way. You know, a deer. And he didn't know what a deer looked like. And so she thought she would help him. And so she gave him a prompt and said, just think about what your mother calls your father at home. And so he looks at the deer and says, so that's what a baboon looks like? Well, we need to quit carrying grudges and carry our brothers and sisters and be nicer and watch out for the words we say. Abraham Lincoln, 160 years ago this coming Saturday, June the 16th, 1858, Abraham Lincoln recalled these words that I read from Scripture. A house divided against itself cannot stand. 160 years ago this coming Saturday. And so it is with us, with our reunions, with our houses, with our country, with our world. As we pray for peace, as we pray for President Trump, and we pray for North Korea and that situation, that there actually might be peace, as we pray for all of the situations in church and outside of church, as we pray for God in our homes, we pray that we are not divided, but that we find strength from one another. I'll close with this story. It's a story of a carpenter showing up at an older brother's house. The older brother was a farmer. His younger brother was a farmer as well. The older brother and the younger brother for 40 years had planted together, had plowed together, had lent one another their farm machinery. They had done everything together. It was a two-man operation that was done as one. But then they got mad about something, and they quit getting along. They quit sharing their equipment. They quit helping each other. And then things got worse. The older farmer, the older brother, said to the carpenter, as the carpenter asked, "Is there any work that I can do around here? Is there any work that I can do?" The older brother said, "Well, my brother and I don't get along anymore. Just last week, he rented a bulldozer and bulldozed the levee to the river, and what was a meadow," and he pointed, "is now a creek bed with water flowing through it. I want you to do something, build me something, so that I can get back at him. I don't care if it's an 8-foot-high fence or whatever. I want you to build something to get me back at him." He said, "I'm going to be gone for the rest of the day, and when I get back, we'll talk. I'll see your handiwork. I'll pay you, and I'll let you know if I want to keep you on." And so the farmer came back later in the day, and he looked, and across that creek that his brother, his little brother, had caused, the carpenter had built a bridge. Now the older brother gave the carpenter a fit. "I told you to help me get back at him." And the carpenter calmly said, "Get back at him? Get back towards him? Get back at him? Isn't that what a bridge does?" And just as the farmer was about to blow his top, he looked up and he looked across the bridge, and there was his younger brother with his arms up saying, "After I've done all that I've done to you, you've built the bridge. I'm so sorry." And the older brother said, "I'm sorry too." And they met in the middle, and they shook hands, and they embraced. And then they both looked at the carpenter and said to the carpenter, "Sir, couldn't you stay around longer?" And the carpenter said, "I've been building bridges between enemies for 2,000 years. There are more bridges to be built." In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our hymn is number 368, "My Hope Is Built." May we stand.
Thank you.
And now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the power of the Holy Spirit be with you and stay with you forevermore. Amen.
Awesome.